Hey guys, it's Jess, and this is Vlogmas Day 9. Wow, that's crazy to me. That's just crazy. I just realized that this is sitting not quite high enough. So let's lean it back a little bit. There we go. That's a much more comfortable height. So, Vlogmas Day 9. Unbelievable. Today I do have a topic in mind, I promise, but I wanted to show you the snow in the background today because I'd like to remind you that where I live, this is like a miracle. We never have snow like this here. It's not unheard of for us to get snow, but we don't get much, and then usually when we do get it, what we get is like really heavy, wet, like really good packing snow for making like snowmen and snowballs. And we are getting dry, light, the type of snow that you get on like the top of a mountain. It's powder, which is insane. So it's light as a feather. Like not only is it falling, but it's also like dancing and swirling around and blowing and all this stuff. It's going in a million different directions, and it's just crazy. I've shoveled it twice today already, and normally I would maybe be able to manage shoveling my driveway once, and it would have taken me an age. I was walking today with the snow shovel literally one-handed pushed in front of me, just pushing it out of the way so that it wouldn't build up and be a real huge nuisance for when my husband comes home this afternoon. Anyways, I did want to showcase the lovely snow today, even though mostly what you're doing is looking out at my neighbor's, you know, back windows. So today's topic is I am going vegetarian. And for some of you, this may seem odd that you're hearing this now that I'm not already a vegetarian or a vegan. I know a lot of people in the witchy, new age, whatever you want to call it, pagan community are already vegetarians, if not full-time vegans. Some of the big names that I can think of just in the tarot community I know are like hardcore dyed-in-the-wool vegans, like Kellyanne and Kelly Bear, both of them very strict vegans. But I'm not. And I wanted to talk to you about the process for me of becoming a vegetarian and why it is more than just a natural, goes along with my spirituality kind of process. Certainly for me, becoming a vegetarian has a lot to do with ethics and moral reasons behind it. But my story, I think, is quite a bit different than a lot of other people's. Yes, I am very similar to a lot of other vegetarians in that even as a young child, I didn't enjoy eating much meat, and I certainly attempted to avoid it whenever possible, or eat the minimal amount that was expected of me before I could, you know, get away with leaving the table and things like that. But even when I was older and I moved out of my house, what for a lot of people signaled the perfect time to fully convert to vegetarianism and then just go for it, that is not what happened for me. And a lot of the reasons in choosing to go vegetarian now are very similar, and they're wrapped up in the reasons of, say, getting some of my piercings done that I have in the last year and a half, and finally going through with getting my first tattoo and things like that. These are some things I have wanted to do for a very long part of my life, if not being able to say all my life, because I obviously didn't know my own mind enough as a baby, toddler, very young child. But from as young as I can remember, having enough knowledge and enough maturity to understand some of the reasons behind why I wanted those processes done that I wanted done. So it's this last couple of years have really been a chrysalis year for me, or chrysalis years, going through those really deep introspective moments and months and years of really looking at myself as a person and looking at how I've lived my life and looking at my beliefs and my values and my ethics and really analyzing them. Why do I believe that? You know, what do I believe, first of all, and why do I believe that? And, you know, like, am I committed enough to that belief to do something about it? Is that something that feels right for me? It was very easy for me to make those decisions when it came to, like, getting a piercing or a tattoo done. You know, they've kind of always been those things I've teased my mother about. You know, oh, one of these days I'm going to get piercings and tattoos, you're not going to recognize me. And, you know, it's always been something that I've been able to kind of call my own, is my own appearance. But how I've chosen to eat, that for me is something so much bigger and it's not difficult in the moment for me to walk into a tattoo or a piercing shop, hand them over my money and say, I want that. And picking it out and putting it on my body, sitting down in the chair, having them put the needle through the skin, the cartilage, whatever, and walking out with it. It's an easy choice, even though I am actively participating in the process of it. Someone else is, in the end, doing some of those processes for me. So it's very easy to kind of take myself out of it, even to a degree, you know. Someone else is the one putting the tattoo gun on my skin. Somebody else is the one putting that needle through my skin and putting that piercing into place. It's also very easy for me to do that with clothing. Before I had kids, yeah, I would say I cared more about how I dressed and what my appearance was. After children, that became less important. And now as my children have begun to grow up more, how I'm choosing to display myself to the world in my as far as my clothing is concerned, that is becoming more and more important. Again, however, when it comes to my daily habits, you know, what I'm doing from the moment I wake up in the morning until the minute I go to bed at night, food and drink are both a important and a background part of, I would say, I would argue certainly my life, if not everyone else's as well. And it's very easy to go autopilot on those things, to make time and effort to do things like meditating and spiritual practice and pulling cards for the day and, you know, making time for ritual and things. It's quite another, at least for me, to then apply that as well to every single morsel of food that I, you know, that passes my lips. And I've never super enjoyed cooking. I would never say that preparing a meal is something that brings me tons of pleasure and enjoyment the way that it does for a lot of other people who like to cook or bake or blend drinks or things like that. So it's been even easier for me to kind of justify to myself why I haven't made the effort to say commit fully to this change in the past, because I'm a lazy cook, and it was so easy for me to just explain off to other people when they would find out, oh, you're not a vegetarian, why not? Oh, I'm a lazy cook. Well, what do you mean? Well, you know, researching and cooking alternate protein sources, that's hard. You know, I know how to cook beef or chicken or fish. You know, I've been doing that for a long time, but I don't know how to cook beans. I don't know how to cook lentils or other things like that because they were not a part of my diet growing up at all. My dad was and still is a notoriously picky eater. And, you know, I know it's a struggle for my mom to find meals for them to make for themselves, just the two of them now, that are exciting and flavorful for her, but not too out there for him. My perfect example of how picky of an eater my father is it was only a few years ago when they were on a cruise, and I think they were on a flight to the cruise area, that my dad actually tried yogurt for the first time. We grew up hearing him say he didn't like it for years, and we all thought, including my mother, that he had actually tried yogurt and had decided, no, he didn't like it. It turns out on that flight, he was so hungry that he actually ate the yogurt that came with his breakfast meal or whatever. And my mom said he scraped it down, put it down. She didn't even think about it, that he was eating it, and it didn't really occur to her that that was out of the ordinary until all of a sudden he goes, you know, that's actually not that bad. And my mom goes, did you eat the yogurt? And then she goes, hold on, that's actually not that bad. Does that mean that that's your first time trying yogurt? And he goes, well, that's how picky my dad is. He wouldn't even try something as simple as yogurt as an adult until he was put in the position where he was so hungry that it was like, either I eat the yogurt or for the next 4 hours, I'm still really hungry. But he still doesn't eat it to this day. His excuse is, what? It's a culture. Anyways, so growing up, you can probably imagine hearing that my dad didn't like yogurt. You can probably imagine that we didn't have a lot of variety or exciting options available on our table on a regular basis. The most exciting thing that we ate in all of our diet were two things. One of them being Old El Paso taco kits, and the other being stir fry, when my mom would actually take the time and the trouble to make it. And her argument was, I don't like to make it because it takes too long to chop all the vegetables. So, yeah, I didn't grow up with very many options at all. I would have been considered, up until probably just a few years ago, quite the picky eater, and I think still a lot of my friends would even call me a picky eater. And I find myself in the position that my dad is in a lot, where I get presented with these very new and different food options, and I find myself literally afraid to try them. And I tell this to my kids all the time, it's just food. If you don't like it, you know, you eat the first bite and you go, yep, that wasn't really pleasant. I don't think I need that in my life again. And then you pass it over for something that you do like. And yet when it comes to actually pushing myself out of the box to try new foods, it's difficult because I don't find myself in a lot of restaurants these days that serve very new and different exciting options of food. Most of the time when I hit up a restaurant these days, it's with my family. So we're talking your typical family restaurant with your typical westernized food. And so there's not a lot of different things on that menu for me to try. And then when it comes to preparing a lot of new and different foods in my house, again, I don't really like to cook. So where does that leave me? It left me putting off the decision that I wanted to make for myself to become a vegetarian for years. And I would tell, and I have gone through the motions of attempting to become a vegetarian many times. I think just in within my own like 7 or 8 year relationship with my husband Neil, I think I've told him I'm going to go vegetarian and then attempted to do that for like a week or so, probably 3 or 4, maybe even more times than that. I kind of have cycled around to it every so often, and then I push myself into it. I jump in with both feet, but I don't do any actual preparations of learning how to cook some flexitarian meals so that I can prepare for both myself and my possibly meat-eating family. And I don't learn how to cook alternate protein sources. I don't learn how to incorporate certain other foods into my diet on a regular basis. I half-heartedly do it, and then when I inevitably fail a week or maybe two at the most later, it's no surprise to anyone. And all I've really done as far as making changes in my diet is I have omitted the meat, and that's it. And that's maybe fine for a week or two if I'm trying to, detox my body a little bit and feel a little bit healthier. If I'm trying to, say, get over a stubborn illness or a stubborn cold, and so I start with cutting out meat so that my digestive system is, relaxed, and that energy can go towards fighting colds or flus or whatever the case may be. But it's quite another to make that change for life. So about, I'd say about the week before Andrew's birthday, I decided, yes, indeed, I am going to go vegetarian. So that's halfway through November. And this time I decided to do it differently. One of my dear friends, who you guys saw in the tarot pajama party, my lovely friend Ty, she is vegetarian, and she really helped to get me to stop making those same excuses that I had been feeding myself for years, blossoming into becoming the person that I wanted to be has taken a long time. I grew up, as you've heard, my diet was pretty bland, and my life was rather restricted growing up as well. My mom didn't let us do a lot of things or get exposed to a lot of things media-wise that my peers were being exposed to. So my diet was bland, and what I was exposed to was bland. I think it's a miracle that I even came across witchcraft when I did and managed to continue to be able to have enough involvement in that to become an adult who calls herself a pagan and can honestly say that she's living that. Keeping that interest and keeping the knowledge of that alive in my life sometimes took a lot of effort depending on where I was in my life and who I was with and what was going on. But I didn't have that same kind of kick in the pants with choosing to, work towards becoming a vegetarian until quite recently. And, she said to me, one of my excuses was, well, I also have to prepare food for meat eaters. And she was like, well, I work as an au pair and I have to cook meat every week too. And it was like, she has to do it practically every day for the family that she works for. And it was like, oh, well, and that was like, I'm a really lazy cook though. I don't like to cook. And she was like, I don't really like to either. It's like, these excuses are not going to fly. Not with her. And then I suddenly started to realize they're not really flying much with me either anymore. Maybe I should do something about it. And slowly but surely, those ideas began to trickle into becoming a reality. I don't like eating things like hot dogs or homemade hamburgers and things like that. But the nature of my family life and the people that we are with, and the fact that I have young children who do like, say, hot dogs for their birthday parties, put me in the position of I need to have vegetarian options available for that type of thing for when it happens. it was very easy to go and buy vegetarian hot dogs and veggie burgers to keep in the freezer. Suddenly, that excuse wasn't there anymore. I have my veggie dogs and my veggie burgers for when that time comes that I need to suck it up and eat what everyone else is eating. The harder thing is learning, relearning how to eat and how to cook, and to also do it in a way that allows me to continue to indulge my husband's and my oldest daughter's preference for eating meat. I have a feeling that my two children, my Andrew and my Emily, they're not much into meat and eat as it is now, and I see it definitely becoming a huge possibility later on in life that both of them would have no problem giving up actual meat completely. So it's my job to make sure that if I do want to make that change available to them, that they have a variety of tasty meat-free options to try and to regularly eat in their diet. And if I don't make those changes and those alternatives available to them, no one else is going to. I must admit, getting as sick as I did last week could have really derailed me really quickly. But this time I decided that I was going to do things differently. That if I was actually going to walk my talk and decide to go vegetarian, this time I couldn't jump in with 2 feet with little preparation and expect to succeed. I might be able to do that with some things in my life. Some choices and some decisions to be made could be made that way very easily. You say it, you kind of half-heartedly make the changes, and then suddenly you find that it's incorporated into your life, no problem. I knew that wasn't going to be the case when it came to making a radical change to my diet. And so I gave myself permission to ease myself into vegetarianism. And I remember talking to Ty just a few days after my son's birthday party and being like, "You want to know something? It's been a week. I haven't had any meat." And she goes, "Really?" It's like, "Yeah. How are you feeling about it?" "Good." it was really easy for me to make those first exciting changes. But I knew if it was going to be a lasting change that things were going to have to, change. Getting sick, though, really threw me right off course. Obviously, when you're sick, you don't want to eat much to begin with, and that was certainly the case for me. But I definitely found those first few days of being sick and not eating much, continuing to eat vegetarian wasn't difficult. When I did want to eat, it was things like broth or bread or toast or things like that. And it's not hard to, get a vegetarian canned soup and throw some together, and there you go, I've got soup that is feels good to eat because I'm sick and it doesn't have any meat in it. The difficult part I knew would come when you wake up that day and you know you're still sick, but suddenly your body's like, "I'm on the mend and now I need you to feed me. I want all the food." And that was the first day that I was like, "Okay, how am I going to work this thing? Because I do want to continue to eat vegetarian, but I also want to give my body the protein that it needs to recover. And I'm not yet well enough to be standing around in the kitchen for an age cooking for myself." And I had to kind of let myself off the hook for a couple of days. And I told myself that I was going to ease myself into it. I was going to still allow myself to eat things like chicken and fish in limited quantities or in limited ways as I was easing towards vegetarianism. But I didn't account for getting sick, and I don't feel guilty for having made the food choices that I did in those first few days as I was starting to recover. I did eat some beef in the form of, you know, a canned soup, and I did eat some chicken in the form of a freshly prepared Thai soup with like spicy Thai soup that had rice noodles and broth and loaded with veggies, and it was perfect for clearing out my sinuses because as I was eating it, the spices were working their way through my palate, and I was just, you know, every few bites I'm stopping to blow my nose and stuff like that, and it felt so good to be able to do that. And it was like, that's right, I'm easing myself in. I didn't think I was gonna get this sick. You know, I've got to cut myself a break. I'm not well enough to be researching elaborate new meals and recipes and things like that. Now, however, I've come to the point where I'm not sick anymore. I have enough energy to prepare myself nourishing food. And now is the time when I'm like, yep, I need to get serious. So yesterday was my last, what I want to call, half lazy day, where I mostly ate vegetarian, but I allowed myself little bits of meat here and there, especially when I felt like I was lacking in protein and I needed it to help my body. Today's the first day where it was like, nope, no shortcuts today. And I will continue over the next couple of weeks, particularly because it is the holiday season and there is a lot of busy stuff going around with family-wise and things like that. Now is a time where I do have to, you know, kind of get myself into the mode where I need to be willing to make more of an effort. So it's one of those things where I'm so joyful and I'm so happy that I am finally making this transition that I have wanted to make for a long time. On the other hand, it's a little bit of a balancing act. It's a little bit of a tightrope act to walk because I'm still feeling myself, I'm still feeling around how I want to do this and how am I going to do this. I have to say, I'm living in the perfect age where, you know, going vegetarian could be as easy or as difficult as you want to make it. And if you don't have a lot of food experience, there are wonderful things like books and Pinterest and Google that allow you to kind of fall down the rabbit hole of what else could I eat. On the other hand, you're falling down a rabbit hole and it can be overwhelming and it can be exhausting researching all this stuff. So I am, at the same time that I am navigating all these new foods, I'm also allowing myself to fall back on some, like say, pre-prepared or easier to prepare things as well that make those middle meals that are always more challenging to make a little easier to get through and things like that. For instance, for lunch today, I made an Annie's macaroni and cheese for Emily and myself. However, I added hemp hearts to it and I added a little bit more freshly grated cheese and other things like that to make it more tasty, to make the protein higher, the protein content in it higher and more sustaining and things like that. And so it's nice to be able to go like, yeah, that's what I did for lunch, and now it gives me more energy to focus on what am I going to do for dinner. Planning meals out is also something that I intend to do much more. Doing what I used to do a while ago, which was sit down on a Sunday morning, decide what are we going to eat as a family for our dinners for the next 7 nights, and then looking through the pantry and the freezer and the fridge and, you know, shopping for the ingredients that we need for those dinners that we're lacking, and also for those pantry staples for the kids, for things that they need for lunches for school. Things like bread for sandwiches, peanut butter, and you know, granola bars or snacks or fresh fruits and vegetables to go in their lunch. Things like that. you know, shopping for those pantry staples as well as for things for breakfast and for dinner. And having that plan in place, planning those meals so that I don't have to be constantly sitting there at 4:30 going, I need to have dinner on the table in an hour. What am I going to make? I don't have any meat thawed, so I can't do something with meat. Or if I do, then I have to, you know, put it through the microwave or things like that. It's, putting those plans into place have become, or needs to become, a more central part of how I run my life and my household and things like that. It's being a more responsible parent in the end. And learning to become vegetarian at the same time is just one more little obstacle that I need to navigate while I'm doing that. But I'm so glad that I have chosen to do it, and I'm so glad that I've started to put those steps into place, and that I have started to put that plan into place as I, you know, move into the holidays. It was really nice to go to my mom and say, all right, I know we said last year that we're not going to go anywhere else for Christmas dinner than our own house anymore, but you've been pushing and you've been pushing, so I'll give in. We'll go to your place for Christmas dinner this year, given the nature of family coming who are traveling quite the distance to come and be present for Christmas dinner. But if I'm going to come, you know, I'm going to be one of about 4 or 5 vegetarians present. Do you have a meat alternative option available for us? Because if you don't, then, you know, I'd like to know so that I can prepare it ahead of time and bring it for myself and for the other vegetarians who are going to be there. And I was really proud of myself for thinking that far ahead and for, you know, being willing to step up and to do something about it if my particular dietary constraint wasn't going to be accounted for. And luckily, my mom did think that far ahead and is preparing a tofurkey, but I'm going to bring a meat-free gravy to go along with it, because she didn't think about that. And I am going to be helping her find a good recipe for roasting some squash, because my mom has never done it before. And it's neat to be able to participate in the makings of a whole new lifestyle that I have wanted for a long time. As I said, becoming a vegetarian is just one more thing that I've really just wanted to do for a long time, and have felt the pressures of family or of, you know, not knowing necessarily how to break out of that box of a life that I, you know, grew up in and that I continued to enable myself to be in for the last many, many years. Learning how to break out of that shell and break out of that box and start making some real changes, that has been the biggest theme, I would say, over the past couple of years. Just making better choices for myself and for my family in a lot of ways. I know a lot of, I'd like to also, just before I end this video, which is already quite a bit longer than my other Vlogmas videos, before anyone comments, like, to the effect of, you know, are you thinking about also going vegan? The answer is no, at least not at this point. I know a lot of vegans often will say things like, being a vegetarian is just, you know, a step on the path towards becoming a vegan. It's like your little layover stop on your flight before you get to your end destination. And I think that that might be true for a lot of vegans, that they went vegetarian first before they finally decide to make a more extreme leap with their dietary changes. And I won't say for myself that that's never going to happen, because I don't know what the future holds. You know, I might like to play tarot cards, but I do not consider myself a fortune teller. And I don't know what life has in store for me many years or months down the road. I don't know if I will ever end up calling myself a vegan. At this point, that's not where I'm headed to. At this point, I am headed towards vegetarianism, with the knowledge and the efforts to either limit or to make wiser choices with what I put in my body as far as animal byproducts are concerned. Some of those options are really easy for me. For instance, I don't drink much milk or eat much cheese on a regular basis. I don't eat cheese on its own hardly at all. And when I do, I often end up buying things like goat's milk cheese instead of cow's milk, for instance. But I do love to have a splash of milk in my morning Earl Grey. I do love to have pizza from time to time and have real like squishy buffalo mozzarella that I, you know, slice and place on my pizza and see how it melts and get that real mozzarella texture from it. To me, going vegetarian in the end isn't a difficult thing for me to conceive of mentally, because I already don't eat much meat to begin with. The reason why it's such a difficult change for me is because I also don't eat very many protein, like meat alternatives, protein options either. I don't eat a lot of beans and lentils at this point, and when I do, somebody else almost always prepares them for me. They're in things like chilies or soups or things like that, and so I haven't actually had to prepare them myself. Or if I have added beans into something, I'm ashamed to say that they've almost always come from a can. So learning how to make those changes is for me more about learning how to cook differently and cook more foods and incorporate them, and learning how to continue to cook meals for my family that they like, but to make something for myself, to have to make an option for myself in there that is meatless, so that I'm not having to make two or three completely different meals. I'm just having to make one meal with two proteins, and that to me seems doable. It doesn't seem doable to become a vegan because I do enjoy things like eggs and baked goods that have eggs in them or milk in them and things like that. However, that is where the wiser choices part comes into play. For instance, I no longer allow my husband to buy the really cheap mass-produced eggs that you get at the supermarket for, well, a dime a dozen, shall we say. Not literally, but you know what I mean. They are the way I know the way that those hens are treated and the way that they get those eggs. I also know that it is perfectly reasonable for a dollar or two more to buy a dozen free-run or free-range eggs. And the difference that you see in just the health content, or like the health information about the protein or the contents of, or the nutritional values, is that's what the word I'm trying to use, on the side of the carton. Seeing the difference in the nutritional values between the mass-produced eggs and then the free-run or free-range eggs is staggering. The yolk colors is ridiculous. You know, mass-produced eggs, their yolks are so blandly yellow and there's almost no color to them at all. Whereas the local and well-treated hens with the free-range and the free-range eggs, the yolks are almost orange. There's so much more flavor and texture to them. They cook up nicer, things like that. I enjoy eating eggs like that so much more than I did eating the cheaper and often blander tasting eggs that I purchased before. But beyond that, I've even been making choices to, like, say, go and buy free-run eggs from a farm that I can drive 5 minutes away to from my place to go get them. And I know that these hens live on a farm in a happy coop. They're laying of their own decision and all that kind of stuff. They're not kind of being forced into laying every day with this rigid schedule and treatment and feed and all this stuff. And they're not just eating the food that's being prepared for them, they're also eating things that they should be eating naturally as well. They're getting to eat insects and seeds, and they're pecking at things that they're finding on the ground and things like that too. And in the end, you have happier hens and you have better eggs. To me, that doesn't feel like an unwise choice. It doesn't feel bad to be eating that animal byproduct when I know that the animals are being properly treated themselves. So it is, for me, it's about continuing to limit my intake of mass-produced cow dairy products if I can avoid it. And it's about making wiser choices for things like eggs and stuff like that. And then the other thing that I have had to take into consideration as well is, would I buy things like leather or stuff like that brand new now? And the answer is no, not anymore, not brand new. I agree with Kellyanne Maddox. I will buy those things secondhand without a second thought. I love to go thrift store shopping, and I love to buy things secondhand, both for my kids as well as for myself. And so to me, if I'm not putting that money directly into the pocket of someone who produced that to be out on the shelf, then I have no problem buying it secondhand. I'm not putting it back into that company's pocket. But if I'm buying new, then no, I won't be buying leather anymore. There's so many other options out there that are just as stylish or acceptable, that I don't need to purchase the leather goods anymore. But again, if I want to find them secondhand, cool, works for me. Does that mean that I'm going to get rid of everything that I bought brand new that was leather? No, the deed's already been done. The money's already changed hands, and I can't undo what I've done in my past. So instead, I've just chosen to forgive myself, knowing that I did come from quite a limited upbringing and background, and that it did take me a long time to kind of find my feet on the path of life, to figure out who I am, what I believe, what I stand for, and all that stuff. And so I can't change what I did, I can only change what I'll do in the future. And that is becoming, that is very quickly becoming a warming feeling to me in my heart, to know that I'm making a difference. And I have that courage to look at my mother and say, yeah, sure, I'd love to come to dinner, but you're going to have something that I can eat there too, right? Because if not, then I need to know so I can either prepare it ahead of time and bring it for myself, or so I need to know so that I can say, you know what, I don't think it's fair that you continue to invite me over and then have nothing available for me. It's all part of embracing who I am and being able to look at the critical people around me and kind of give them the polite middle finger saying, that's nice that you think that or that you wanted that from me, but that's not what I wanted for myself. And so if you can't take me as I am, then you can leave me, because I don't need that BS in my life anymore. I've spent far too long hiding in the shadows or playing nice or sucking up to other people, and I don't want to do it anymore. I don't want to shape myself any longer to be what everyone else around me has wanted me to be. I put off being open about my spiritual and my religious beliefs to the people around me for such a long time because I felt ashamed of it, because I knew what they would think. And I don't want to do that about everything else now. I won't do it anymore. And learning to have the conviction to say, this is who I am, and this is who I'm going to continue to be for the rest of my life. So either you need to get used to it, or you just need to walk away. That is one of the most powerful life transformations I think I've ever been through. Having my children was one of them. Being pregnant with them and giving birth to them was one of the most defining moments of my life. Sorry. And you guys, you gotta understand that I've mentally treated myself like shit for so long, for not measuring up to what everyone else wanted me to be, and yet simultaneously screaming at myself for not doing the things that I love, for not living quotes that I've always loved, things like, you know, you gotta live for yourself, and not for others, you know, live the life you want, and things like that. Not living my truth has cost me a lot emotionally. It has probably been one of the single biggest causes behind things like my anxiety and my depressive disorders I have dealt with all my life. Deciding to convert to vegetarianism has just been one of the biggest pieces of the puzzle falling into place for me. And I'm very proud of myself for being able to stand up for myself and to make that choice without being curious what the rest of my family would thought. This was, I think, one of the things where I said, no, this is, I'm doing this for me. You know, I put these piercings in my skin for me. I put this ink on my skin for me. I'm choosing to change the way that I eat for me. And if anyone else doesn't like it, they can go fuck themselves. And I don't think I've ever felt in my life so at peace with being able to act that flippantly, if you want to use that term. I don't think I've ever been so, I don't think it's ever been so effortless for me to just decide to do it and then to stick with it like it has this time. And I think that's a real sign of the times, at least in my life, when it comes to the cycle of my life. I think a lot of it has to do with being in my 30s now and being older and getting to the point where I don't give a fig what everyone else thinks. But I think a lot of it too has to do with being a daughter of the Morrigan and following the path that I have, that working with such intense deities over the last year or two, I've really been asked to sacrifice a lot and to lay a lot of my old beliefs or my old habits kind of at the door and to walk forward a little bit lighter of some of those burdens, but also feeling a little bit heavier too, knowing that there's a whole new life style or there's whole new life choices that I have to pick up in order to proceed, in order to keep walking. I've exchanged one burden for another, but I have to say I would make those burden exchanges all over again. I would make this choice all over again. This is probably one of the single biggest, most wonderful and best things I've ever done for myself. And my mom is always cautioning me that, you know, if I'm going to live a more unconventional life, that I'm going to have to be prepared to deal with some of the criticisms that go along with it. But to be perfectly honest, I think when it comes right down to it, the criticisms of other people have come and gone. They have changed depending on the landscape of people I've been exposed to. But I have been my own worst critic for my entire life, and the things I have wanted to do, the changes I have wanted to make, and the shit I've given myself internally and mentally, that hasn't changed. It's only just gotten louder and louder and louder as I have proceeded closer and closer to becoming the person I've wanted to be. I'm not having to deal with more critics as time goes on. I'm having to deal with less. Those outer critics, those other people, they are so much easier now for me to shut out than they were in the past. And the inner critic is getting quieter and quieter as I'm finally starting to, well, walk my talk. And that first day that I went vegetarian the whole day while my kids were at school, and then my husband and I went out to go see Fantastic Beasts, and we stopped for dinner beforehand, and we were in a burger shop. It would have been so easy to just say, yeah, I'll have a hamburger. And I didn't. I had the soy chicken, the Cajun soy chicken burger, and it was amazing. And it was like, you know, it was like having a conversation with the little angel or the little devil on my shoulder. And at that point when I ordered and I bit into it and I loved it, like both of them, like the angel in me has been saying for years, yeah, do it, go for it, make that effort, make that push. That little devil has always been the one that's like, oh, you can't do it, blah, blah, blah. But secretly also wanting to kind of follow along with the angel as well, kind of just doing its job. And it felt like when I first bit into that soy burger and it was like, oh, this is amazing, this is so good. Like, I kind of looked at both of them, like mentally kind of gave them a little look, and both of them were like, yeah, got you, woohoo! You know, like those little New Year's Eve noisemakers and things like that were kind of going off in my head. And it was like, all I have now is internal support. Fuck yeah, I can do this. So yeah, this is a much longer video than I had ever wanted to make when it came to this. But there you have it, my very roundabout and convoluted change. And I hope that you found this even mildly interesting, because I didn't cry on camera for nothing, people. Anyways, this has been day 9, and I will see you guys all again for hopefully a far less emotional day tomorrow. Bye, guys.